Please stand.
Good morning, everyone. You may be seated. It's great to have you with us this morning. We've got quite a few things, different things going on. It's great to see so many new people. I know some of you are here for different reasons. It's great to have you with us this morning. It's great to have those of you following online. Welcome. It's a communion service this morning. So those of you at home, you might want to get things ready for that later on in the service. It's also an all-age service this morning, so the children, young people, are not going to be going off into their groups. It's also the start of the most significant week of the Christian calendar, Easter week, and it's Palm Sunday, which is why you've got your palm crosses this morning as you've come into church. And so this, I always get excited about Palm Sunday. And also today we are celebrating Mary Irish's 30 years of ministry. She was ordained 30 years ago to the day. That's right, 30 years ago to the day in here. It looked a little bit different then. But we're celebrating that, and many of you are here as we celebrate that this morning. So we're going to have lots of fun this morning. Welcome this morning. Emma, are you around? Where's Emma? Emma. Mummy, yeah, she's coming. We've got some crafts, and Emma is going to just introduce those crafts. Do you want to come up here, or do you want this one? No, I'll let you come up. All right.
So in your packs, you should have a storybook if you're a little person. If you just want to have a read through that, something to keep you busy whilst we're talking. You could also make, because it's Palm Sunday, we're talking about when Jesus went in to Jerusalem. So you can also make your own little pack if you've got that in your pack. Everything you need should be in your packs. And you can make your own, I've lost my straw, so you'll have to excuse me. You can make your own palm leaf, because they laid leaves on the floor when Jesus came in. So you should also have a straw in your pack, as well as a piece of green card and some scissors. Just poke the straw in and you can wave that around. And for the older ones, you can make your own palm cross. You should have your instructions on how to make a palm cross and a very long, thin piece of paper. If you're missing anything in your pack, just give me a shout. Finally, as Chris mentioned, it's the start of Holy Week. So if anybody's interested in some daily devotions for this week that you can do with your family, just come and see me if you haven't already got a pack something in your pack. There's something there for Monday all the way through to Saturday, and then Chris will deal with Sunday, I think. So for the youth, you've got a Bible quiz all about Palm Sunday. So if you don't know the answers, maybe test your parents. And if they don't know your answers, then perhaps find a Bible or ask someone that might know the answers and a word search. So just, yeah, enjoy. If you're missing anything, then just give me a shout. Thank you.
Of crafts to dip down. They're not dipping down. It's incredible, Emma, what you're doing. So thank you. As I said, as we all know, it's Palm Sunday today, and I want to, before I open in prayer and we watch a video, I just want to read as a welcome this morning a well-known verse about Palm Sunday. It is Luke 19:37. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles that they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And that's what we're doing this morning. We're praising God together. So we're going to watch a video that shows the story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem.
The story of Easter, the triumphal entry. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like calming storms and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
At this time, the Jewish people were celebrating a festival called Passover that had been celebrated since the time of Moses, when God brought his people out of Egypt. So Jesus was going to Jerusalem to celebrate. Jesus and his disciples stopped in a town.
You coming?
And Jesus told two of his disciples to go on ahead of them.
Okay.
He told them to go into a village and that they would see a young donkey that no one had ever ridden.
Rock!
He told them to untie it and bring it to him. If anyone asks, "What are you doing?" he told them to just say, "The Lord needs it, and we'll return it soon."
Yeah, okay, go ahead.
So the disciples did what Jesus said and brought him the donkey. A long time ago, before Jesus was even born, God had said that the Savior, the King of Israel, would come to Israel in this way. and now Jesus was doing just as God had said. The news that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem swept through the city. Many heard about all the amazing things he had done, so they cut palm branches and ran to see him.
Huh?
The Pharisees and religious rulers realized that there was nothing they could do, for everyone was going to see Jesus. Jesus rode into the city of Jerusalem, and the crowd spread their coats on the road ahead of him. His followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. The Pharisees were upset.
Hey, Jesus!
And they told Jesus to stop the people from saying things like that. But Jesus said, if they keep quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. So the people kept on singing, blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in highest heaven. The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered, asking, who is this? And the crowds replied, it's Jesus. And Jesus rode the donkey through the street of Jerusalem to the temple in a triumphal entry, just as God said he would many years before.
Just in case any of you wondered what you pay me for, this is what I do during the week. So, I need probably about two or three volunteers who are going to join me in a game of pin the tail on the donkey. Who wants to help? Come on, Zach, you can help. Anyone else? Anyone else want to play this game? Or Ethan, do you want to come down and play? Do you want to play? Come on. Oliver, do you want to play or not? Don't matter. Anyone else? I could do with a third. Come on. Sophie, come on, you can play. Right. Okay, who wants to go first? Well, Zach came out first, so Zach, you can have a go. I'm going to blindfold you, mate. I hope you don't mind. Spin you round, is that all right? Right. You're now facing the board. Go for it. That's not, you can take your mask off. That's not a bad effort at all. That is not a bad effort at all. I'm going to put a marker on here. Right, Ethan, I think you're next.
Hold on.
You think it's going to be easy, do you? Yeah? I'm going to spin you around fast 5 times. Is that all right? Yeah. You've done a challenge like this and got spun round before, but in front of this many people?
No, not with this much people watching.
No. Well, let's see how you get on, yeah? Right, come here. Let me spin you around at least once. Go for it. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. Careful of that. That's pretty good, Ethan. Let's get a marker up here. Sophia, you ready? Come on. Be scared. It's only Daddy. Let's spin you around. Right, go for it. The board's here. Not bad, not bad. Look at that. Well done. Well done. I think a big round of applause for all of them. I think Ethan won. Put your hand up if it looks like a donkey. That's all I'm bothered about. Does it look like a donkey? Yeah, that's good. That's good. About 40, 30% of you. Yeah. Okay. Wonderful, wonderful. Right, there's a reason why we've done that, but we're going to worship God in song again now. So over to the worship team.
We turn to you. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a King of glory.
A short message for us this morning, and then I'm looking forward to interviewing both Mary and Doug, but before I do that, I'm just going to share with you a short message. Let me just pray before I share a message to you this morning. Almighty God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for each other. We thank you for church family, and we thank you for your word. And as we look into your word this morning, I pray that you will speak to us through your Holy Spirit, that you will touch each one of us, and that we will know something about your love for us this morning. In your name I pray. Amen. Now, I've been encouraged recently, and rightly so, to improve the link of the illustrations that I give on a Sunday to my actual message. Sometimes I do an illustration and it's got some kind of vague link in my head, but I don't always make it clear. But this morning, there's obviously a clear link with the donkey. So the donkey, pin the tail on the donkey. Obviously, the donkey is a main character in the story of Jesus's entry into Jerusalem. And also the whole bit of pinning the tail on the donkey blindfolded is a link, because sometimes, and we've been doing an alpha course which is really going really well, and one of the things that we've really come back on in the last few weeks is stepping out in faith, and sometimes our faith being blind faith. So we can't really see the outcome, but we need to step out in faith. We need to make that step in following Jesus. And sometimes as Christians, we just need to make that step of faith. And it's blindfolded. We don't know if we're going to hit the target or not. Sometimes we hit the target. Sometimes we get it slightly off. And that's all right, as long as we keep trying. So that's the link for the pinning the tail on the donkey this morning. Okay, I want to read to you the passage that was highlighted in the video. I'm not going to read all of it. I'm going to read from Luke 19, the end of 29 through to 41. So Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.'" Those who were sat ahead, went and found it just as they had been told. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles that they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it. I'm going to stop there. Now, the first point that helps us in our walk of faith is that Jesus chose a donkey rather than a horse. Jesus chose a donkey, not a horse. Now, I don't know where young people, there's a lot of young people upstairs. If you were a king and you were traveling into Cambridge, what kind of transport would you take? I want to ask that question. I want some feedback.
Helicopter.
We've got a helicopter. Yeah, that's a good answer. Anyone else? Boys? Look, you look shocked. What would you take? A car. Any particular type of car? Lamborghini, Porsche, something like that. Maybe we would choose something different to a donkey. If we were a king, I'm sure
we wouldn't ride into Cambridge or wherever on a donkey. I want to read to you what the prophet said, Zechariah. It's 9:9-10. So this is before Jesus was born. This was said about him. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey. It goes on to say, he will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from the sea, from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. Jesus chose to come on a donkey. And I think this is a really key point for us. It's not about what we have, it's about who we have. And, you know, teenagers, and not just teenagers, I'm not just picking on teenagers, but I'm really conscious that they want the best tracksuit, they want the best trainers, they want the best mobile phone. And it's not just teenagers, it's all of us. We look for the best things. We look for the best things. But it's not about what we have, it's who we have. Jesus knew who he was when he traveled into Jerusalem. And we don't need to worry about what we have. We need to consider that when we go forward, Jesus is with us. Jesus lives in us. The second point that I want to look at, I want to read verse 36. Verse 36 says, as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. I want to challenge you this morning. What do we need to lay down before Jesus? What do we need to lay down before Jesus? Is anyone giving up something for Lent? Anyone? There must be one or two. There must be someone giving up something for Lent. Chocolate, I know. What, Ed and Joe, what are you giving up for? Sweet stuff, just in general, not just sweets, just sweet stuff. Wow, how's that going? Sweet stuff. We give up things, don't we? Oh, Eleanor. Giving up YouTube. That is a right idea for our family. TikTok, YouTube. Yeah, that's give up. We could give up those things, couldn't we, for a period. Wow, this is amazing. We give up things so we can focus more on Jesus. And I just want to encourage you this morning that as we're approaching Easter, as we're approaching the time where Jesus gave up his life for us, what are we considering to lay down for him? What are we considering to lay down so we can focus more on him? The third and final thing that I want to say, from verse 41, it says, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it. I was challenged by this as I read this this week. What does God want you to get compassion for? What does God want you to weep over? That's what I was challenged for me personally. And I want to say that to us this morning. What is it that we, at this Easter time, that we need to consider, actually, that's what we need to cry over. That is what we need to pray over. That's what Jesus was moved by compassion for Jerusalem. And we're called to be like Jesus. And God, sometimes we get lethargic in our faith. Sometimes we plod along. And sometimes we really get compassion. We really get a heart for something. It might be for the lost. It might be for our neighbours. It might be for a circumstance going on around the world. It could be for so many different things. I want to challenge you this morning. What is it that God wants you to weep over? What is it that God wants you to be compassionate about? So three things we can learn from this story. There's so much more we can learn. But Jesus chose a donkey, not a horse. It's more about who we have than what we have. What is it at this Easter time that God wants us to lay down, to give up, to lay down, to put aside so we can focus more on Jesus? And what is it that God wants to stir our hearts for, that we become really compassionate and we weep over? Okay, so that's my message for us this morning. And I'm now going to invite Mary and Doug to come forward. I'm going to interview them. I what they don't know is we planned some questions at the beginning of the week. They're binned. We're starting afresh. We're starting anew. So that was a joke. That was a joke. You never know with Chris. What do you mean? Right. Is it? Well, we haven't started yet, though. Is this one on? Yeah. Just make sure your seat's not too near the edge and you're flying off the... is this working? Yeah, this is brilliant. Okay. So the first, this is great to have you guys up here. We're doing the guns now. Right. So it's great to have Mary and Doug with us this morning and to celebrate them. It's great to have some of your family. And some are following online, I think.
They're sick.
Some are up in the balcony. Some are down here. Some are following online because they're unwell. They're all watching. And I thought, what an opportunity. What an opportunity to ask the first question. Which is your favourite grandchild? Come on.
You can answer. Come on.
You don't need to answer. Go on, what were you going to say?
I was just going to say, every one of them is very special.
Oh, look at that. Absolutely. Right, we better get going, otherwise we'll be here until... Okay. Right, so tell us something, and this is for both of you. Tell us something that we might not know about yourselves.
Oh, well, I don't know how many of you do know, but after my passion for God, that comes first, and my passion for my family, my next passion is swimming. And I was a serious swimmer years ago, and I still absolutely love it, and swimming, teaching, and every grandchild has to learn to swim in our family. So well done, Sam, who can now beat me. Lottie's nearly there. Josh has just started swimming, and Lucy is now swimming. So George at 4, come on, it's your turn next.
Okay. Well, I guess the locals here will tend to think of me as a building project. My passion, my real passion over many, many years was actually, and hang on, you have to hold this a minute.
He's doing the strip tease now.
Was actually midweek Christian youth work, and I led a group in Sawston, big group there, and we shared in two F's, faith and fun. And then I did a lot of work both regionally and nationally in training youth leaders. But I'm all for midweek Christian youth work. And this was given to me on a visit to Antigua many years ago with the BB Anchor and the Sure and Steadfast, which of course comes from Ephesians. We have an anchor that is sure and steadfast.
Very good, very good. I'll be honest there, Doug, I had a terrible fear as you were taking your top off then. that was the Manchester United logo.
Dearie me, we were going to end the interview there and then. Okay, so the second, this is just for Mary, is this one. Mary, what's been the biggest challenge for you in ministry?
Oh, well, there's one that is...
Apart from me.
There has been one, and I think it probably is for most ministers. It's how you get the proportion right of your time for your family and for your ministry. And I do think that's quite a tough one. And I failed many, many times. I'm sorry, family, when I often have. But my biggest joy is that my family, both my daughters are committed Christians. They were both worship leaders before they produced all these children. And the children are also coming and learning about the faith. So, yeah, that was... But there is another challenge, and you won't have had this one, Chris. 30 years ago, if you can remember, Anglicans didn't have women vicars, right? So when I had to go and buy my first, or get hold of my first clergy shirt, they hardly existed. And they were built, they were made around men. Well, there is a slightly different shape for women and men. So I have to say it was quite a challenge. And what happened in the end, a very dear friend of mine actually made me my first clergy shirts. It's improved now, but that was a real challenge.
That wasn't the answer I was expecting, but anyway... Yeah, you're absolutely right. I've not had that that challenge. Okay, so Doug, this is for you. Give us one advantage and one disadvantage of being married to a minister.
Well, the advantage is an easy one. We used to get a bottle of sherry from the Undertaker at Christmas.
Wine.
Disadvantage, well, remember, Mary for many years was a hospital chaplain, and that meant the phone would go at about 3 o'clock in the morning saying, we need you. Well, it's all right for the phone to go, but somebody has to kick her out of bed and make sure she doesn't trip over the slippers and generally pack her off into the hospital at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yep, I can relate to that one. Mary, what are you most thankful for?
Where I have got quite a few.
Okay.
I've got quite a few right. Thanks. I'll try not to be too long because I have got an awful lot. Of course, I'm thankful to God. You know, those of you, if you're newer Christians, you'll often find you don't kind of really quite know what he's asking you to do at the time. I don't think discernment's that easy. But when you look back, you see that he has been so faithful. And he's been there in every situation. And I guess that's probably what I'm most thankful for. But in human terms, I'm also thankful. And some of them are here today. Special, special people who have actually kept me going. Ministers do need support. Big time. It's really true. And those of you here today, you know why I've asked you to be here. And you're really special. And thank you for everything you've done to just sort of keep me going over the 30 years. And the other thing I want I'm thankful for, I'm going to embarrass hopefully one or two people now. I was actually ordained here at this moment, and I must admit, as I knelt down in the old bit, and I was being ordained, and I did say some prayers, was please God bring revival to this church and to our community and to our land. And I also prayed, please do something about this building. It's taken 30 years. But you see that God, he does it. But the other thing I want to say thank you for is those of you who were all elders at the time. And I've invited you here today because some of you are still here. Some of you have gone on. And virtually every one of you has gone on to some form of Christian ministry. And I think that's absolutely incredible. It's wonderful. It's a great joy for me. So would you like to stand up, those of you who were elders 30 years ago? Go on. Dave, Sarah, Jean up the top. Paul Preston, who's come back, and he's there as well. John Thorne, couldn't now be here today, but he was here as well. And, where's Jane? Oh, there she is. And Jane as well. So look at these people and just say thank God for what they've done and their commitment, because eldership and leadership, it's not just ministry. It is a commitment before the Lord. And all these people have kept that promise of their ordination, which is to follow him always. And thank you. Can sit down now. I'll let you off. Thank you. Yeah. Paul's wife actually ended up, and she's actually an Anglican vicar now, so she couldn't be here today because she's doing that. So isn't that wonderful? What has come from this church? And those of you who are now in position of eldership, thank you for all you do, and thank you for the future.
Lovely. And finally, for you both, if you could give any bit of advice to anyone going into ministry, what would it be?
Well, the flippant answer would be, don't. The more serious answer, I think, would be, basically, make sure that your husband, wife, is totally on board with you for what it involves for them. I must admit, when Mary first thought of doing it, was I that sure? Was I that happy? Probably not, if I'm really, really honest. But she did it, and it was the right thing. And I'm very proud of what she's done.
No, you've made me feel thinking about it. You've forgotten what the question was. What advice would you give? Oh, go for it. If you feel anybody feels any sense of call and it's there, just go for it. God will be there. He'll be in it. Don't rush necessarily. Talk to people who you trust. Let them test it out with you. You don't ever do this alone. And I would say do that. But if it's there on your life, that call, go for it. Well, I want to just say one of the things I did during COVID was to write down my journal entries into a book, and because Doug will turn his hand to anything, he managed to print it very cheaply, so it doesn't cost anything. They're free. There's copies of the book out in the where we're all going to have coffee. Hopefully, you'll all be able to stay afterwards. So, do have, you know, if you'd like a copy of it. It's a copy of sort of meditations, and I suppose really a lot of my thoughts. But it's a fairly easy read. So if you want a copy, just help yourself, please do. Okay.
Do you want to, we're going to watch a video now. Do you want to introduce that quickly?
Go on, you introduce.
Okay. So Doug's edited it, hasn't he, or something. Yeah. There's a video, a short video, of the ordination of Mary here 30 years ago. So we're going to watch that now.
Okay, we're going to worship God in song, and then Mary's going to come forward to lead us in communion.
Am I on? Yeah. One of the great privileges of ordination is to be able to lead people in communion, and that's what we're going to do today. One of the things I didn't say earlier, and I do just want to say, I don't know if any of you realise when we sang A New Generation is Rising Up, was one of the songs earlier, and I really believe I'm stepping back, not completely, of course. I will be here, and older people can probably mentor in a different way. And our generation stands back, and we stand back now because we see in this church a new generation rising up. Thank you, Chris, for all you are doing in your ministry to encourage that. Thank you for all the people who are becoming Christians. Thank you for a new phase in this church's life. Amen. And And thank you, God, for your timing, because it's perfect. So it's over to the young people now, or the younger. I call you young. You probably think you're middle-aged, but you're young to me. We're going to celebrate communion, and we in this church invite the children to be part of it if the families want to. It's up to parents. You're with your parents, and you decide amongst you whether it's the right moment, whether it's right for you. But Holy Communion is very, very special. When you're very young, it's probably a bit difficult to really understand the full meaning of it. But I was thinking about it in its Holy Communion. It's holy because it's to do with God, and it's incredibly special. So if you're young and you don't quite get all the bigger things to learn, remember it's holy. And the second thing is what communion means. It means being very close to somebody, and that's being very close to God. And we're going to be very close to Jesus. And of course, Holy Communion is something much bigger, because especially this Palm Sunday, as we're moving into Holy Week, we're going to remember all that Jesus has done for us. So let's just pray. We thank you, Jesus, so much for your gift of Holy Communion. That when we eat this bread and drink the wine, we will remember what you've done for each one of us. We're sorry that we've messed up many times, but we thank you that you forgive us completely. And I want to pray now that this bread that we're going to share will be the body of Christ, and this wine, the blood of Christ. So Holy Spirit, come. Bless these things that we eat in your name. But more than ever, Lord, touch each person here with the reality that you live within them always. Amen. So you are very welcome to share what we do. If any of you are visitors and are not used to communion, we, our elders, will take the bread and then the wine round to you. And what we do is we eat it together. One of the things about our tradition is that we're remembering the great moment, almost the heavenly banquet. There's something about doing it together that's really important, and it's part of our tradition, so just remind you of that. But here we are on the night that he was betrayed, which of course will be this Thursday when you'll be having Passover and remembering what it was. But on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he broke it, he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." If the elders would like to.
Thank you.
So this is the body of Christ that's broken for every one of you. Take and eat it. And then Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." And as you drink this, remember that the blood of Christ was shed for each one of you. So let's just pray. Father, we thank you so much for what you've given us here. Thank you that you've fed us with the bread of life and with the drink that gives us a knowledge of you. Father, thank you that you come so close to us. And I pray this week that everybody here will go through Holy Week and see more of your love for each one of them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Mary. I'm going to invite Al, I think, to come down and lead some notices. We've got one or two notices this week.
Good morning, everybody. For those of you that don't know, I'm Al. I'm one of the elders here. And a big welcome to you all, especially to our visitors and to those that are online on Zoom. So I'm just going to talk you through our notices. One of the things I love about this church is just how much is going on. You know, we're a real community here, and so there's so much that happens throughout the week, whether it's our prayer meetings that happen on a Tuesday or Friday on Zoom. We have our Jelly Beans crash group that meets on a Thursday morning. And then there's house groups that meet throughout the week. So, Joel, if we can move to our next slide. Hopefully this will be a picture of some of the house group leaders. I haven't got a picture of everyone. Hopefully most of them are on here. House groups are a great way just to get to know other people in the church, to read the Bible together, to do life together, to pray for one another. There's different groups that meet throughout the week. Some are online, some are in person. So if you'd like to join a group, come and speak to myself or Chris after the service. Or if you recognise any of these beautiful faces, go and speak to them. So on to the next one, please, Joel. We still need people for the grass cutting rota. No, we don't. Oh, Rich has got everyone, so that's good. So ignore that notice, and thank you to everyone last week who responded to that. The next thing is our Easter egg hunt. That happens next Saturday, and it's a joint event with St. Mary's. So the younger children, Key Stage 1, are going to be meeting at St. Mary's to do the Easter egg hunt at 10. And then at 11 o'clock, Key Stage 2, that's older primary, are going to be meeting here to do an Easter egg hunt. So do sign up for that. We do need people to sign up so that we've got numbers. Next slide, please, Joel. We are desperate for leaders. So Debbie, who's sat down there, smothered in children, and Emma, who's also looking after children, they're doing a fantastic job in organising that event. But we do need some people just to help, just to be stewards, to smile and welcome people when they come in. So if you can help with that, please speak to Emma or to Debbie after the service, and they'd be really delighted to hear from you. Doesn't need to be a big commitment. It's just for an hour and a half on Saturday morning at 11. Okay, next one. Easter services. It's Holy Week, as Chris said at the beginning. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday this week at 8 o'clock, we're going to have what we call our Holy Reflections, or our Easter Reflections. So it'll be different people leading it. Chris will be leading on the Monday. Janet Crowhurst will be leading on Tuesday, and then I'll be leading on the Wednesday. And it'll be a real mixture of just reflecting on the message of Easter, maybe spending some time praying, spending some time in sung worship. But if you can get along to one of those services, I'd really encourage that. Then on Thursday, we have our Passover meal. That's at 7 o'clock in the hall. If you haven't bought tickets, Richard, are there tickets left? There are tickets left. Rich is at the top. You can't see him if you're down below. But please speak to myself or Richard, and I'll point you in the right direction after the service. There's £10 per ticket, and I'd really encourage it. I'll have a great time when I've been to that previously. Alex Jacob, who's also at the top, will be leading that. So that's Thursday. On Good Friday in here, we'll have our Good Friday service. Then on Easter itself, at 7 o'clock, we're meeting at the old BT Exchange, walking up to the top of Rivey Hill where there's a bench, and we'll be having a service. Hopefully it will be sunny. Hopefully it won't be raining. In past years, it's been a really wonderful experience. So do join us if you can. Bring your friends, your neighbours, your dogs, whatever you'd like to bring. Bring them along on that Sunday morning. And then at 10:30 in here, we're going to be having our Easter celebration service. So that's Easter. Are there any more? Any more? Passover meal we've talked about. Next one, Joel. Oh, yeah. Just a date for your diary. The coronation big lunch is something that's happening across the UK at the coronation weekend. After the service on that Sunday the 7th of May, we're going to have a picnic in the garden and hopefully share some fellowship time together. I think that's it. Next slide. Lots going on, so please do sign up for our newsletter. You can point your phone at the screen while the QR code's there and that'll take you to the right page, or just log on to our website, lintonfreechurch.org.uk. I think I'm done, Chris.
Thank you, Al. Okay, so we're just going to, before we sing our final song, invite Mary to come forward. We've got, and Doug, you can come as well, Doug. But look at this. Linda has made a nice little cake for you there. And we have some flowers on behalf of the church. We're doing this now because Linda is dashing off. And so Linda's made this cake. Just show everyone this. Beautiful.
Both of these two ladies.
Yeah.
They became Christians 30 years ago when I was here. Yes. Both of them.
Wow. Brilliant. Yeah, awesome. I didn't know. Well, no, yeah, I don't know. But so let's give Mary a round of applause for her 30 years. That's a wonderful cake. It's my tenth year. Which is, all right, okay, yeah. 90s. Well, right, okay, yeah. Thank you.
It says, Mary, congratulations on 30 years of ministry.
Absolutely, absolutely. Doug, I do want you to come forward as well, because I'm just going to quickly pray for you guys. Hope you don't mind. And then we're going to sing our final song together. So let's pray for these guys. Almighty God, we want to thank you for Mary and for Doug. We want to thank you for their faithfulness. We want to thank you for their ministry over the last 30 years. And Lord, we just want to pray that in this new season for them both, Lord, that you will bless them, that you will pour out your spirit afresh upon them, that you'll continue to use them in different ways, but you'll just bless them, Lord, and just fill them afresh with your spirit. May they know your guidance and your blessing upon them in the coming days, weeks, and years. And again, we just thank you, Lord, for them and for their ministry. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Bless you guys. We're going to sing our final song.
Was
to welcome you all to come back for tea and coffee and cake in the hall. You're more than welcome to join us for that. Let me close with a word of prayer. Lord, we praise you and we thank you that we don't need to be restricted to this place, this building, to praise you. Lord, I pray for each one of us as we leave here this morning, that we know your spirit with us, that we know your presence with us. And Lord, I pray a blessing upon each and every person, from the youngest child right through to the oldest here. Lord, bless them this week. May they know your presence and your love for them this week, this special week. Help us to focus on you, to prioritise you this week. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys, and you're more than welcome to join us next week.